We now have Dr. Deepak Rai on stage. Dr. Deepak Rai is consultant orthopedic surgeon at Yenapoya Specialty Hospitals. He is an arthroplasty surgeon and ortho specialization in navigation knee. Thank you for being here, sir.
Good morning, one and all, and greetings from the city of Mangalore. Thanks to Dr. Kailash and his team for creating such a wonderful platform and a very good number of speakers here. My talk today is on the evolution of polyethylene, a weak link in total knee arthroplasty, as it has been cited as one of the reasons for revision total knee arthroplasties. So, just before I go into talk about polyethylene, which probably not many of us don't know much about, I'll just talk about the history. As many discoveries in orthopedic practice, polyethylene was also discovered accidentally when Juan Pechmann in 1898, he heated diazomethane. Of course, this was a very unstable part, and this polyethylene could not be replicated or was not been able to made stable. Over the next 37 years, every attempt was made to stabilize this polyethylene, but it was unsuccessful till the year 1935, when Michael Perrin first developed a reproducible method to synthesize polyethylene, which was stable. However, this was all commercially available and not medical grade polyethylene. Medical grade polyethylene, the credit goes to Sir John Chanley, who created the low friction arthroplasty hip, which stands the test of time even today. Basically, before we go, let me talk a little bit about polyethylene and its manufacturing, which is manufactured basically by two ways. One, it's either the raw material is compressed, molded into sheets and machined into bars, or what we do in polyethylene is, the medical grade polyethylene is where the resin is compressed, the powder of the resin is compressed, molded into the product that we want, into the tibial inserts that we want, and it is given out. But this was the first generation of polyethylene, and it was known to have wears, backside wears, the cams would break out, the poly would also break out, and hence people tried to decide to increase the cross-link, the connectivity, and so came the ultra-high weight molecular polyethylene, where it is a subset of polyethylene with extremely long chains, with a molecular weight between 2 and 6 million units. This, however, again, was introduced in 1998, and slowly people realized that they wanted something better. So they created the highly cross-linked polyethylene. This polyethylene was created by gamma radiations, however, with the exposure of free radicals. Now, what happens to these free radicals? That's something which is very, very interesting. These free radicals cause cross-linking and they increase, that's why it's called as highly cross-linked poly. But then again, these free radicals also had one misadventure, meaning that when it was exposed to air or oxidized, it causes degradation of the poly. So it works both ways. Hence, from polyethylene, you have ultra high weight, molecular weight polyethylene to the highly cross-linked polyethylene, which got from gamma radiations. To offset these free radicals, they introduced the additions of vitamin E, which was 0.1% by weight, and it was added by a process called annealing. And I'll tell you what exactly is annealing, because most of us, we do not understand about all these things. So hence came the second generation of poly, highly cross-linked poly, which was blended with vitamin E. So when gamma radiation is applied, you have residual free radicals. And this residual free radicals, the vitamin E scavenges. So it helps to reduce residual, the free radicals which is there. So basically, the free radicals help in cross-linking, but at the same time, when it's exposed to atmosphere, it's degraded into, it causes a degradation of the poly, and that's why many of the surgeons insist on not opening up the poly till at the time of the insert. Sterilization is also very important. Many companies use ETO sterilization now. Previously, gamma sterilization was used because gamma sterilization again causes the degradation of the poly. So, as we know, this poly characterizing is actually from each process, from making in the thermal process or irradiation to the endpoint sterilization, it has got ways of degradation. The problems, obviously, which we always know, is the wear and the osteolysis, which in the knee, we see a lot of osteolysis around the collateral ligaments, in the femoral attachments, and under the tibial base plate in the tibia. These osteolysis is caused by wear debris, which are created either by the metal or from the bone cement itself or from the your poly. And in the presence of macrophages, which are getting it induces the osteoclast or increased osteoclastogenesis, and this causes the osteolysis of the bone. So basically, like Dr. Sachin and JV also told, the causes of wear could be because of the implant design, surgical techniques, patient factors, and also the properties of polyethylene. I'd like to go through a few of the papers, and one very important paper which talked about polyethylene in arthroplasty was by Jakovsky from the Orthopedics Research Institute in Arizona. And he said that cross-linking increases the bonds between polyethylene and hence increases the resistance to forces and delaminations also. But the production of highly cross-linked poly requires the exposure of radiation from 5 to 10 millirads. But this generates free radicals, because of which it causes oxidation of poly. So the best way to reduce the free radicals was to heat it below its melting point, and that is at 135 degrees, and that is called as annealing. So these polys are always heated to just below its melting point so that the free radicals are removed off, which increases the ductility and also, decreases the ductility and also decreases the resistance to crack propagation. Another very important paper was done by Yu et al., who looked into the cross-linked versus conventional polyethylene in total knee arthroplasty. What these people did is they took up all the data from Cochrane, Medline, Embase, and Science Direct, and they removed off all the gray areas of studies which were there. And finally, they concluded that compared with the conventional polyethylene, highly cross-linked poly did not improve the clinical and radiological outcomes in mid-term follow-up. This didn't have a long-term follow-up. Vitamin E was studied by Yamamoto, and he said that it has got its several advantages in protection from oxidation to conditions of cyclic loading. Fatigue strength was improved, and the reduction in biological activity and wear debris, and possibly a reduction in bacterial adhesion and biofilm. But vitamin E stabilized polyethylene has been there since 2010. So we still do not have a long-term data on vitamin E polyethylene. Analysis regarding the tibial rotating platform, tibial components, it showed that there was wear in the superior and in the inferior articular surfaces, and there's no clinical evidence to prove that improved survivorship at 15 years between fixed and mobile bearing. Even there was no remarkable difference between an all-poly and a metal-based modular PS knees, with a survival rate of 98% at 11.34 years. And I'll talk about one new talk, which is how to determine the osteoclastic activity in synovial fluid. And this was tested by Amar Ranawat in the recent papers in 2015, JBJS. And he said that you can measure the levels of tartrate-resistant acid phosphatase. Possibly this will be telling us whether the wear osteolysis is going on. They also said that we need to have 50% of skeletal calcium to be lost before its evidence is seen on radiographs. And an MRI is much more sensitive method to determine osteolysis, which is as specific as 95.4, as compared to 74.7% in CT, and maybe less than 51% in a plain radiograph. Take-home messages: highly cross-linked poly is advantageous in total hip arthroplasty, but probably not so much in knee. No appreciable differences in outcome between ultra-high molecular weight polyethylene and the first generation highly cross-linked poly. The second generation highly cross-linked poly, which is a vitamin E laced, has come to clinical use since 2010, and we still have too early to comment about its long-term beneficials. Thank you, one and all, for this patient hearing.